Lesson 13 Sabbath, June 30, 2018. Meeting the Bridegroom. Watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh. Lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping, Mark 13 verses 35 and 36. It is in a crisis that character is revealed. When the earnest voice proclaimed at midnight, "Behold, the Bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him," and the sleeping virgins were roused from their slumbers, it was seen who had made preparation for the event. Both parties were taken unawares, but one was prepared for the emergency, and the other was found without preparation. Christ's Object Lessons, page 412. Suggested reading, Christ's Object Lessons, pages 405 to 421. Sunday, June 24. 1. A parable for our day. Question A. With whom does the Lord compare the kingdom of heaven? Matthew 25 verses 1 and 2. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps, and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. Christ with his disciples is seated upon the Mount of Olives. The sun has set behind the mountains, and the heavens are curtained with the shades of evening. In full view is a dwelling house lighted up brilliantly as if for some festive scene. The light streams from the openings, and an expectant company wait around, indicating that a marriage procession is soon to appear. As Christ sat looking upon the party that waited for the bridegroom, he told his disciples the story of the 10 virgins, by their experience illustrating the experience of the church that shall live just before his second coming. The two classes of watchers represent the two classes who profess to be waiting for their Lord. They are called virgins because they profess a pure faith. Christ's Object Lessons, pages 405 and 406. Question B. What was the difference between the wise and the foolish virgins? Matthew 25 verses 3 and 4. They that were foolish took their lamps, and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. Monday, June 25. 2. Do not sleep as do others. Question A. What aroused the sleeping virgins? Matthew 25 verses 5 and 6. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him." How was their experience repeated by God's people in 1844? By the tarrying of the bridegroom is represented the passing of the time when the Lord was expected, the disappointment, and the seeming delay. In this time of uncertainty, the interest of the superficial and half-hearted soon began to waver, and their efforts to relax, but those whose faith was based on a personal knowledge of the Bible had a rock beneath their feet, which the waves of disappointment could not wash away. The Great Controversy, page 394. Question B. What warning does God give us concerning the times in which we live? Luke 21 verse 36. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. 1 Peter 4 verse 7. But the end of all things is at hand, be ye therefore sober, and watch unto prayer. All we have to do with is this one day. Today we must be faithful to our trust. Today we must love God with all the heart and our neighbor as ourselves. Today we must resist the temptations of the enemy, and through the grace of Christ gain the victory. Thus we shall watch and wait for Christ's coming. Each day we should live as if we knew that this would be our last day on this earth. If we knew that Christ would come tomorrow, would we not crowd into today all the kind words, all the unselfish deeds, that we could? In Heavenly Places, page 355. Question C. What can we do to arouse from our sleeping condition? Romans 13 verses 11 to 14. And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand, let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly, as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying. But put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh, to fulfill the lusts thereof. We must be much in prayer if we would make progress in the divine life. When the message of truth was first proclaimed, how much we prayed! How often was the voice of intercession heard in the chamber, in the barn, in the orchard, or the grove? Frequently we spent hours in earnest prayer, two or three together claiming the promise. Often the sound of weeping was heard, and then the voice of thanksgiving and the song of praise. Now the day of God is nearer than when we first believed, and we should be more earnest, more zealous, and fervent than in those early days. Our perils are greater now than then. Souls are more hardened. We need now to be imbued with the Spirit of Christ, and we should not rest until we receive it. Testimonies, Volume 5, pages 161 and 162. Tuesday, June 26. 3. The need for oil. Question A. What happened when the virgins awoke and went to trim their lamps? Matthew 25 verses 7 to 9. Then all those virgins arose, and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you, but go ye rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves. In the parable, all the 10 virgins went out to meet the bridegroom. All had lamps and vessels for oil. For a time there was seen no difference between them. So with the church, the lives just before Christ's second coming. All have a knowledge of the Scriptures. All have heard the message of Christ's near approach and confidently expect His appearing. But as in the parable, so it is now. A time of waiting intervenes, faith is tried, and when the cry is heard, Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him, many are unready. They have no oil in their vessels with their lamps. They are destitute of the Holy Spirit. Christ's Object Lessons, page 408. Question B. What is represented by the lamps and the oil in the parable? Psalm 119 verse 105. None. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. Zechariah 4 verses 1 to 6. And the angel that talked with me came again, and waked me, as a man that is wakened out of his sleep, and said unto me, What sayest thou? And I said, I have looked, and behold a candlestick all of gold, with a bowl upon the top of it, and his 7 lamps thereon, and 7 pipes to the 7 lamps, which are upon the top thereof, and 2 olive trees by it, one upon the right side of the bowl, and the other upon the left side thereof. So I answered and spake to the angel that talked with me, saying, What are these, my Lord? Then the angel that talked with me answered and said unto me, Knowest thou not what these be? And I said, No, my Lord. Then he answered and spake unto me, saying, This is the word of the Lord unto Zerubbabel, saying, Not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. What does it mean to be destitute of the Holy Spirit? Without the Spirit of God, a knowledge of His word is of no avail. The theory of truth, unaccompanied by the Holy Spirit, cannot quicken the soul or sanctify the heart. One may be familiar with the commands and promises of the Bible, but unless the Spirit of God sets the truth home, the character will not be transformed. Christ's Object Lessons, page 408. Question C. How would you describe the foolish virgins today? 2 Timothy 3 verse 5. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Revelation 3 verse 17. Because thou sayest, I am rich, and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched, and miserable, and poor, and blind, and naked. The class represented by the foolish virgins are not hypocrites. They have regard for the truth, they have advocated the truth, they are attracted to those who believe the truth, but they have not yielded themselves to the Holy Spirit's working. They have not fallen upon the rock, Christ Jesus, and permitted their old nature to be broken up. They do not know God. They have not studied His character. They have not held communion with Him. Therefore, they do not know how to trust, how to look and live. Their service to God degenerates into a form. Christ's Object Lessons, page 411. Wednesday, June 27. 4. Making excuses for our deficiencies. Question A. What happened while the foolish virgins were separated from the wise virgins to buy oil for their lamps? Matthew 25 verse 10. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. The 10 virgins are watching in the evening of this earth's history. All claim to be Christians. All have a call, a name, a lamp, and all profess to be doing God's service. All apparently wait for Christ's appearing. But 5 are unready. 5 will be found surprised, dismayed, outside the banquet hall. Christ's Object Lessons, page 412. We cannot be ready to meet the Lord by waking when the cry is heard, "Behold, the bridegroom," and then gathering up our empty lamps to have them replenished. We cannot keep Christ apart from our lives here, and yet be fitted for His companionship in heaven. Christ's Object Lessons, pages 413 and 414. Question B. What did the foolish virgins petition the Lord of the marriage feast to do? Matthew 25 verses 11 and 12. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But He answered and said, "Verily I say unto you, I know you not." Question C. How do we often react when we fail God, instead of acknowledging our sins and mistakes? What did Saul do, and what was Samuel's response? 1 Samuel 15 verses 18 to 22. And the Lord sent thee on journey, and said, "Go and utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they be consumed. Wherefore then didst thou not obey the voice of the Lord, but didst fly upon the spoil, and didst evil in the sight of the Lord?" And Saul said unto Samuel, "Yea, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord, and have gone the way which the Lord sent me, and have brought Agag the king of Amalek, and have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. But the people took of the spoil, sheep and oxen, the chief of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God in Gilgal." And Samuel said, "Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams." There is no time to make excuses and blame others for our backslidings, no time now to flatter the soul, that, if circumstances had only been more favorable, how much better, how much easier, it would be, for us to work the works of God. We must tell even those who profess to believe in Christ, that they must cease to offend God by sinful excuses. Jesus has provided for every emergency. If they will walk where He leads the way, He will make rough places plain. He, with His experience, will create an atmosphere for the soul. He closes the door and brings the soul into seclusion with God, and the needy soul is to forget everyone and everything but God. Satan will talk with him, but speak aloud to God, and He will drive back the hellish shadow of Satan. With humble, subdued, thankful hearts they will come forth saying, "Thy gentleness hath made me great." Manuscript Releases, Volume 12, page 336. Thursday, June 28. 5. The call for today. Question A. What call does God have for us today? What promise does He make along with the call? Malachi 3 verse 7, last part. "Even from the days of your fathers ye are gone away from mine ordinances, and have not kept them. Return unto me, and I will return unto you, saith the Lord of hosts. But ye said, Wherein shall we return?" Isaiah 44 verse 22. "I have blotted out, as a thick cloud, thy transgressions, and, as a cloud, thy sins. Return unto me, for I have redeemed thee." Isaiah 55 verse 7. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Oh, the love, the wondrous love of God! After all our lukewarmness and sins he says, Return unto me, and I will return unto thee, and will heal all thy backslidings. Our High Calling, page 352. Those who will now seek the Lord earnestly, humbling their hearts before him, and forsaking their sins, will, through the sanctification of the truth, be fitted to unite with the members of the royal family, and will see the King in his beauty. This Day with God, page 248. Question B. As we heed the call, what message does he give us to proclaim to the world? Isaiah 40 verse 9. O Zion, that bringest good tidings, get thee up into the high mountain, O Jerusalem, that bringest good tidings, lift up thy voice with strength, lift it up, be not afraid, say unto the cities of Judah, Behold your God. The last rays of merciful light, the last message of mercy to be given to the world, is a revelation of his character of love. The children of God are to manifest his glory. In their own life and character they are to reveal what the grace of God has done for them. The light of the Sun of Righteousness is to shine forth in good works, in words of truth and deeds of holiness. Christ's Object Lessons, pages 415 and 416.